and welcome to this very special show. My guest is former Reserve Bank Governor and Professor of Finance at Chicago Booth School, Raghuram Rajan. Dr. Rajan, thank you very much for joining us. A very happy Diwali to you.
Very happy Diwali to you, and happy Deepavali to your southern listeners.
Okay, thanks a lot for that. Well, first up, let me start with things global before I come to things Indian. We seem to have a dichotomous growth. The US is chugging along with excellent job creation, while we're seeing the IMF marking down growth in Europe and, more importantly, in emerging markets like China. Do you think we are going to have this two halves growth for some time now?
Well, I think initially we will have that because the U.S. Has the benefit of a substantial fiscal stimulus, which is going to take it growing into next year. However, the world is so tightly integrated that if one part slows, the other part eventually does also slow. So my guess is by the end of next year, when the stimulus has fully worn off, I think you will see the U.S. coming back to earth.
Okay. What about interest rates, though? I mean, we've got such good wage numbers and job creation numbers coming out of the United States. Amazon is raising wages. That's telling you something about global inflation. What's your sense about interest rates and about global liquidity? Will it continue to get tighter for emerging markets?
Well, the latest job numbers, as well as wage growth, 3.1% year on year, will suggest to the Fed that they should continue on their path of rate hikes. So my guess is that they, at this point, are set on one more this year and maybe three more next year. Mm. What this means is monetary policy is going to get tighter the world around. By the way, the ECB is also going to stop its QE by the end of this year. So except for the Bank of Japan, which is still pretty much set on its very accommodative policies, the rest of the world is starting to tighten. So both in terms of interest rates as well as liquidity, things are going to get more difficult as we look ahead.
Mm-hmm. Is this bad news for emerging markets? You know, last time around from 2003 to 2008, as the Fed started tightening, it also meant good U.S. growth and therefore EMs prospered. Will it work that way or will this not work that way positively for EMs?
Well, there is a difference this time, which is that part of the spectacular U.S. growth is driven by a near end of cycle fiscal stimulus. Mm. So one of the worries that people have is as the Fed tightens, it's tightening given the very strong growth in the U.S., but that growth may not last because some of it is fueled by a stimulus. Mm. That said, I think it's premature to say that this tightening process will necessarily create enormous problems for the emerging markets. It typically does, but markets do tend to differentiate between well-managed emerging markets and poorly managed emerging markets. So I think it's extremely important, especially for India at this time, to have really spectacular numbers on the sort of macro stability front so that emerging markets look at that and say, this is a well-managed economy and we are treated with respect in the difficult times to come.
How would you assess the Indian macros at this point in time? After hitting trade deficits of $18 billion for a couple of months, we have come down in September to $14 billion. The fiscal deficit, at least efforts are being made to stick to the number. Do you think we get a tick mark? Do you think the instability on the currency is behind us?
Well, I think there are some places where we have done a good job. Certainly on the inflation front, we are in a much better situation than in the past. And I think both the government and the Reserve Bank deserve credit for keeping inflation low. I think the other aspect that is generally good is we do seem to be growing faster than most other countries, of course, from the perspective of the level of our GDP, as well as what we need to create the jobs to keep our youth employed. We probably need somewhat more than where we are today. Mm. Where there is more worry is on the fiscal deficit front, and here I'm not talking just about the central government fiscal deficit, which has been coming down, but the aggregate fiscal deficit. Even as the central government is bringing it down, the states are taking it up. When you look at the total, you find that over the last 3 or 4 years, the aggregate fiscal deficit has actually gotten slightly worse, not better. And the second, I think, big problem which we're facing today, of course, is the current account deficit is blowing out, partly because of relatively weak exports and partly because, of course, the price of oil has gone up. It's come down recently, but it's a risk that we cannot ignore at this point.
Mm-hmm. Oh, what about the debt problems that we are facing? You may be up to date with the fact that there is a lack of trust in several NBFCs, especially housing finance companies. Do you think this can become a very big issue? Stimmy growth itself?
Well, yeah, I think there is concern in the corporate debt markets about the caliber of the rating agencies, as well as who has good balance sheets and who has not. Mm. I think this is a good time for those entities that have relatively weak balance sheets, especially if the debt they've taken on is not yet due, for them to shore up their balance sheets. Typically, this means issuing equity so that they actually can put some backing behind any possible weak assets that they have. Mm. I think the markets are somewhat nervous. But I don't think, given that NBFCs account for 17 to 18% of assets, this is an unmanageable problem. I think we can manage it. Mm. We have to look carefully at it, see what is really a solvency issue, what is a liquidity issue. And certainly on the solvency front, it's up to these privately managed entities to raise equity at this point when they still have the capacity and shore up their balance sheets. Mm. I think there's a tendency sometimes to run to the government and say, please bail me out. Mm. I think first they have to exhibit everything they can do on their own before the government even contemplates anything of that sort.
Well, I don't know how much you're updated on the showdown that this has created between Reserve Bank and government. Now, one of the demands of the NBFC sector and those who see that problem as possibly contagious is that the Reserve Bank should provide not just general government security liquidity through OMO, but must specifically provide a line of credit or some kind of comfort to NBFCs. Is that possible at all for the Reserve Bank?
Well, I think in general, let me talk about central banks because the specific issue I may not be the best informed on. But in general, central banks avoid lending to direct entities because often that requires a level of credit evaluation, which simply central banks do not have and should not presume to have, because they're not in the fiscal function of bailing out entities directly. Of course, in a generalized crisis, they sometimes enter in a big way. The Fed did. The RBI has done in the past. But I think before that, you have to ensure that this is really a liquidity problem. If it's a liquidity problem, the central bank can flood the market with liquidity or give liquidity to specific private entities that are healthy and that are willing to lend to these other entities that are in trouble. Mm. If they're willing to lend at a particular price, that suggests that it is a liquidity problem and they're willing to fund these entities. If nobody is willing to lend to these entities, that means it's a solvency problem. Mm. If it's a solvency problem, then, of course, there's a fiscal function involved, and typically the government should get involved in that rather than the central bank.
Okay. It's...
In other words, when you bail out private entities, it requires a serious thinking on what exactly it is.
Okay. Now, go ahead. What do you think the Reserve Bank should do in a situation that it is now in, where, there is... it's a cycle. There are companies that are not putting their money into mutual funds, which have commercial paper of NBFCs. It's a trust deficit. How do you break this trust deficit?
Well, I think, again, if generally when there is a liquidity problem, the central banks try and solve that by putting liquidity into the market. That means lending against high-quality paper. Mm. That means lending to high-quality institutions so that they have the capacity to on-lend if there's necessity. If that is done, I think the central bank has primarily carried out its function. If there's further money needed because entities are severely undercapitalized or because they have losses on their balance sheet, or because markets distrust them and refuse to lend to them, then we have something which is different from a liquidity problem. We really have something which looks much more like a solvency problem.
Okay.
In that case, I think much closer examination is needed of the particular issue. And certainly, some of this can be remedied, as I said, by companies going out and issuing equity to bolster their balance sheets. If their market value is still significantly positive, it is possible. And if even the equity markets are closed to them, then at that point, which is very far from where we are, a bailout could be contemplated. But that bailout has to be carried out by the government because ultimately taxpayer funds will be involved.
Okay. Well, time permitting, I'll come back to this. There is a severe disagreement between the government and the Reserve Bank on the liquidity issue for the following reason, that 11 banks have been put under prompt corrective action with three filters, either because their capital is not up to the Reserve Bank's requirements, or because they have higher net NPAs than 6%, which means they've not provided for their NPAs enough, or three, because they have negative ROA. Now, the government's position has been globally prompt corrective action is resorted to only with a capital filter, not with net NPAs and ROA filters. What would you say is the correct position?
Look, I don't, again, want to enter into the specifics of the debate. Let me tell you broadly that I think there is a little bit of a misunderstanding in this debate about what the RBI is supposed to do. I think Dr. Viral Acharya gave the analogy of T20 versus test match. But let me give you another analogy. The RBI is something like a seatbelt as a driver, the driver being the government. It has the possibility of not putting on its seatbelt. But of course, if you don't put on your seatbelt, you get into an accident, the accident can be quite severe. So most drivers listen to that annoying noise which comes when you don't put on your seatbelt and actually put on the seatbelt because they know it's for their own good. And historically, the relationship between the RBI and the government has been precisely this. The government wants to focus on improving growth, and it does all it can within the limits set by the RBI, which are set based on financial stability. Mm. So the government will push, will try and get the RBI to be more lenient. Mm. And there were innumerable letters, both from industry as well as government, which came across my desk saying, please relax this, please relax that, please relax something else. And the understanding was we would examine that in close detail, see what the risks to financial stability were, and then say yes or no. Mm. When we said no, the government understood this crossed the Lakshman Rekha in some sense of stability, and that we would be held responsible. Mm. We have responsibility for financial stability, and therefore we have the authority to say no. Mm. They would respect that and come back the next day with another letter saying, what about this, what about that? And we'd keep examining all these possibilities. Okay. This has always been the relationship between the RBI and the government. Mm. And if you recall, I think there was this anecdote by Dr. Subba Rao when he talked about this phone call between Dr. Reddy and Mr. Chidambaram. Mm. And he was listening to Dr. Reddy's side, and Dr. Reddy said, no, 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 and finally said yes. And he said, you know, what were you saying? He said, well, Mr. Chidambaram was asking for this and that and something else. And I kept saying no. So why did you say yes? He asked me at the end if I could hear him. And I said yes.
Okay.
So,
yes.
I mean, that's the notion of the relationship between the RBI and the government. Of course, the RBI doesn't say no out of petulance. It says it because it has examined the situation and believes that this implies too much financial instability.
Okay.
I think that relationship has gone on for long. Mm. And, you know, the fact that the RBI says no is not new. Mm. Now, the government can keep asking and say, please consider this, please consider that. Mm. But at some point it says, okay, I respect your decision. You are the financial stability regulator and I back off.
Okay. But the other point in which, we don't get into the details of prompt corrective action. But one general rule which the Reserve Bank has applied is 9% capital adequacy, although Basel requires 8%. Now, Deputy Governor Vishwanathan just the other day explained in detail that Indian risk weight calculations are looser than that of Basel and global requirements. Be that as it may, the government's contention has been, why are you trying to be stricter than what Basel requires? Why don't you lower it to 8? Even in your time, it was 9%. So what's the Reserve Bank stand there?
Look, I think the Reserve Bank takes a view based on how it sees the Indian economy. If the Reserve Bank follows blindly Western practices, the Reserve Bank gets accused of being in the thrall of the West. There are people who've made those accusations. Mm. If, on the other hand, we tailor to Indian conditions, we are asked, well, why don't you tailor to Western conditions? I think you can't choose, pick and choose which regulation you like and which regulation you don't. There are many places where the Reserve Bank is actually more lenient than, Western regulations. I think we repeatedly had Indian banks getting into trouble, for example, in Singapore, because Singapore said they weren't meeting Singapore standards, while in fact they met Indian standards. And we had a lot of back and forth about this. We are not necessarily the strictest regulator. I think that's a problem, that we are not actually as effective as we should be, and we're making progress in this path. But I don't think there's much to be gained by pointing to one regulation and saying this is loser or that is loser. Again, make the case to the RBI. The RBI will decide. But ultimately, the responsibility for financial stability lies with the RBI. Mm. Once you've appointed these deputy governors and governor, you have to listen to them because that's what you appointed them for. They're your safety belt.
There's a third point of contention, which is perhaps even more, irritable for both sides, and that is the government wants Reserve Bank to part with its capital. It believes that it is overcapitalized, and you know there have been several studies on this even during your time. Do you think that that's a legitimate contention? Should the Reserve Bank give in part of the way, part of the capital? What's the way to find meeting ground? Because there doesn't seem to be any.
Yeah. Look, this is a contentious issue and sometimes a poorly understood issue. So let me try and explain a little bit. Mm. One, the Reserve Bank's equity is a wholly owned asset of the government of India. It doesn't belong to the Reserve Bank. It's the government's equity. And certainly, it ultimately is an asset of the government. Now, beyond that, there is a question of how well capitalized the central bank should be. Now, like any entity, a corporation, which does deals abroad, the reason for adequate capitalization is for counterparties to believe in the strength of the Reserve Bank and to think that they will the Reserve Bank will honor promises it has made. For example, when we did the swap deal in 2013, it was a commitment by the Reserve Bank that it would honor those swaps. Mm. And without the kind of equity that we had backing us, it would be difficult. So the board, in my time, essentially decided that a viable sort of level for the Reserve Bank would be to have a AAA credit. Mm. Why AAA? Because India itself has a country rating of BAA, and so relying on the country rating would give us very high cost financing if we ever went out to get that financing. Instead, we should have a balance sheet which is itself cast iron and capable of raising money in dire need from outside with a AAA rating. So that was the decision of the board. And since then, we've tried to put out an analysis of what it would take to get that AAA rating. So that's one, the creditworthiness of the Reserve Bank. Second, what can it pay out as dividends? Well, the accountants, especially a really respected one like Mr. Maligam, who used to be on the board, told us that you cannot pay more than the realized profits. So that is number two. You have to realize the profit. You cannot just pay out what is not realized profit. So, for example, the gains on the assets, the unrealized capital gains, which is a big part of the RBI's equity, which comes from the foreign exchange assets we hold, we just can't pay it out like that. That's number two. The third, which is the least understood but perhaps the most important in constraining the RBI, is that every year it can only create so much money. Now, beyond that, essentially, additional monetary creation would be inflationary. So every year we set ourselves a target, and that is the money that is used to buy OMOs in the market and essentially provide indirect secondhand financing to the government by clearing space in market balance sheets for them to buy government bonds. Now, the reality is that amount is limited. If today, let us say the government wants a 3 lakh crore dividend, and that can be realized based on the first criterion that there's enough in the balance sheet, and two, that we have profits which allow that payment, it still will hit the third criterion, that we can't create 3 lakh crores of additional money without selling government bonds in the market to take it back, because otherwise it would be inflationary. The bottom line is there is no free lunch here. There is no additional money the government can get, because whatever we pay will have to be taken back beyond that profit that we pay to them as dividends. So by all means, there could be a debate about whether the entire profit is paid or some is held back. My guess is that with the recent depreciation of the rupee, the balance sheet is healthy enough. Remember, we hold dollar assets. So the balance sheet is healthy enough that possibly the entire profit could be paid. But whether there's an additional windfall, I'm afraid that these constraints actually prevent that. I have tried explaining this many times, you know, in speeches and so on. Unfortunately, because it involves monetary economics, it's a little harder to understand.
Okay. Well, you know, what if the board... See, in your case, the board said that the Reserve Bank should have AAA status. What if the board... I mean, there is a board meeting coming up on November 19th. If it told the Reserve Bank governor to hand over a part of the capital...
Well, so let's I think, address the issue of what the role of the board is, right? The role of the board in the Reserve Bank has historically been not to take operational decisions, but really to focus on broader strategy as well as ensure good governance. So they are there to ensure the government's sort of money is well spent in the Reserve Bank, that, for example, the Reserve Bank doesn't pay itself inordinate salaries and so on, but also to serve as a sounding board, which is why we have people from different walks of society. We very eminent people have been on the board, including Dr. Kakorkar, Padma Vibhushan, Ila Bhatt, whose work is known all over India. These were people on my board. And when they spoke, you listened, because they had useful advice to give. They rarely tried to put themselves in the position of the professional sort of Reserve Banker and say, you must do this or thou shalt do that. Instead, we put proposals before them, and they weighed in saying, we would advise this or we would advise that. We'd go back and think and come back, and eventually they'd be fine with it. So my sense is the objective of the board is to protect the institution, not to serve as, to serve other interests. It is to protect the health of the institution, but also to provide wide sensible advice. Let me end by saying the aim of the board is to be a Rahul Dravid. Sensible, thoughtful, not with due respect, a Navjot Sidhu.
Okay. Well, I'll just come to this in a bit. I have to quickly get a couple of questions through you. You know, the Reserve Bank, the government started consultations with the governor under Section 7 of the Reserve Bank Act, which has never been used hitherto. So it clearly looks like the government wants to have its way. Does that upset you itself, per se, the usage of Section 7?
Well, I don't think the government has used it so far, and I don't know how many times the usage has been threatened in the past. So I don't think we should read too much into this right now. I think certainly it would be best if each side respected each other's sort of motivation and thoughts. And ultimately, the Reserve Bank, after listening to the government and hearing what the government's issues were, provided the best professional answer it could. And historically, it has done that. Mm. I have no doubt it is doing that today. It has a responsibility to fulfill to the nation. Mm. And it has to listen, of course. Mm. But at the end of it, after listening, it has to make a decision, mm. because ultimately it has that responsibility.
Yeah. Things apparently are much hotter than that. This is the information that we have got, that the government and the Reserve Bank and the board and the Reserve Bank also perhaps are not seeing eye to eye on several issues. Now, if on November 19th or earlier or later, the Reserve Bank governor finds that he's asked by the board to do something which he doesn't want to do, I mean, if there is a resignation, how bad can that be if the governor were to resign?
Look, I don't want to address a hypothetical, and I hope that these issues are resolved. Mm. Ultimately, it can only be resolved if both sides respect each other's intent as well as autonomy. And I worry that in the recent past, mm. A lot of unnecessary noise has been inserted into the board deliberations. And I wonder if this is something that can be unwound or rolled back, perhaps by by taking away some of the people responsible for the additional noise. I think there is a healthy relationship, and in these uncertain times, and mm-hmm. I think Dr. Acharya should be commended for just sounding a warning. I don't think that I've seen a lot of press saying he's comparing India to Argentina and so on. I don't think that was his intent in any way. I think he was just saying, let us be careful in these uncertain times. That's a warning that is important for us to heed, mm-hmm. and heed it in the way it was given, respectfully, recognizing the fact that the RBI is not above the government. It is an arm, if you will, of the government, and saying, look, as a responsible part of the government, it is my duty to warn that there are certain issues if we go further. I think that we should take that into account. These are not good times to be labeled a country which doesn't respect the autonomy of the central bank. One of the things that, as I said, that on the macro front we are doing well on is inflation. If, in fact, there is the worry that the government could run roughshod over a central bank, as Dr. Acharya pointed out, in some countries, it hasn't been a good thing for that macro economy. And so I think respecting that warning and understanding India is very different from many of these countries, we should not walk down that path. And I think it's important for both sides to back off, and for some, hopefully, elder persons in the government, as well as former RBI people, to create a better understanding between the two.
Okay.
And it may, again, I say, require looking at what has prompted this recent angst and trying to deal with that problem.
Okay. Well, I believe I'm running out of time, but very quickly, Trump has criticized Powell. Theresa May has criticized the BOJ, the BOE governor. If things came to a pass where the governor didn't want to continue, will it be taken in that stride that in all countries, even in developed countries, these differences are happening? And will it be taken in the stride, or can it be very damaging?
No, look, I think you have to look at the extent to which institutions are protected in different countries. I think in the United States, for example, Mr. Trump simply does not have the ability to fire the chairman of the Federal Reserve. The chairman has been approved by the Senate. And to that extent, there's a much more elaborate and different process. Mm-hmm. I think in India, there has been an unwritten understanding that, in fact, there will be a viable relationship between the government and the Reserve Bank governor, and that these things will not get to a pass where the relationship breaks down. I think it would be very unhealthy to ever get near the position where things go further. So I think as far as possible, it is in the interest of the country that we stay away from that, that we respect the institutional autonomy of the Reserve Bank, as well as the traditions. Ultimately, this is about traditions on both sides, and that we respect the traditions that have got us the kind of institution, which I think the Prime Minister on the 80th anniversary was very, very appreciative of the quality of the Reserve Bank, and I think we should protect it as a national institution.
Well, I do hope the relation between the government and the Reserve Bank is not as infructuous and as difficult to solve as it is between the United States and China. Raghuram Rajan, it's always a pleasure having you with us. Thank you very much for joining us, and have a great Diwali and a great new year ahead.
Thank you. Same to you and same to your listeners.